Swimsuit? Check. Sunscreen? Check. Phone charger? Check. Don't forget to pack the 5-Hour Energy. It fits great in a pocket or carry-on, and the alert feeling will help you arrive ready for anything. Now get 20% off when you use code 5HETRAVEL at 5HOURENERGY.com. Expires April 30th. One-time use only. Not valid with other discounts. Remember, visit 5HOURENERGY.com and use code 5HETRAVEL to save 20%.
Gearhart's back.
The more things change, the more they stay the same.
From NJ1015.com, this is the new Jim Gearhart Podcast.
And we're on.
Yeah, so we were invited back again, Bob.
Yep.
To my great surprise.
Who invited us? You did.
Well, in spite of all manners of decency, with geometry, religion, we got the invitation.
Today's
back
September
again.
19th, 9/19/19.
That's right. I saw that when I wrote it down. I, my discharge date from the Navy was 5/5/55.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, I don't remember when I went in, but...
Do you remember when you got out?
I remember when... You better believe I remember when I got out. I wanted to say something about the grip. I'm going to go back to the grip hat. I was sort of giving up on it. But I think the people who supported grip, get rid of incumbent politicians, and people still do that. But I think we are a proud elite group right now that we should celebrate, and I'm sure you do the same, the same thing. What was the old Marine recruiting commercial? The few, the brave,
the few, the proud?
The proud, yeah, the that's brave, it. Yeah. So everybody, hang
few,
on
the
to
proud,
your
grip the jerseys, yes.
A story here. This is great news for parents. Something that you've always wanted if you're a parent. How much time have you lost from calm or even from sleep worrying about the kids? Are they learning something? In other words, the behavior of the kids as regards the
the
values
okay
that you teach them at home, and you feel responsible, and when your kid messes up, does something, you kind of feel guilty about
it. Oh, it's a reflection on
it's a
you
reflection.
It's
what
parent.
Did I do
yeah,
wrong
right.
Why didn't I do that? I'm responsible. Now it finally at last it, you are no longer responsible for your children.
Really?
Yeah, so you can forget it. It's not your business. Now, I say that, I think I mentioned this last week, but I want to get into a little more detail about it because I think it's very significant. There was a school in California, in fact, several schools, who issued a 79-question questionnaire, and it was to children ages 6 to 8 years old. Now, remember, this is an elementary school, 6 to 8 years old. Among the questions, many regarding their sex life.
Wow.
Honest to Pete,
6 to 8 years old, that's probably kindergarten to maybe second grade.
Yeah, right. Now, here, and the kids had to fill this out. It was mandatory with a lot of other questions, too, regarding social issues by and large.
Okay.
They said, how many times a day do you think about sex? Do you think about how often do you think about touching other people's private parts?
What?
I mean, that's a couple of questions, and there were more.
Now, where is this survey?
In California.
Oh, God.
Well, where else would it be?
Oh, for
no,
this
is true. Now, obviously, this got some pushback. And it got to court. A group took it to court of parents and concerned people, and the lower courts in California all said, no, this is fine. They wanted it stopped, the questionnaire. So it got up to the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals, those lovable,
oh, those
madcap
rascals.
Scamps. Now, the ruling was by the Court of Appeals that the schools could continue with this because, and I quote, education is not only about reading and math and science, but education serves a higher civil and social function, including the raising of children into responsible adults. So they're saying, in effect here, that it is the state's responsibility to see that your children become responsible adults, not yours. So I say it's terrible news for the country for the future,
yeah.
But it's good news for parents because you can always say, it's not my fault.
It sounds like child abuse to me.
When the police come to the door, just go down and check it out with with the authorities.
And do parents, by and large, know that their children are being questioned?
Oh yes. Well, that was the point. Right. The parents were horrified.
Right.
Horrified. Well, you know, I don't understand or don't know the whole story, but there are apparently in California parents who are having their children mutilated, changing their sex when they're, 3 years old? Mm-hmm. It must be, because this is what this television host who had just gotten up to a higher program, and he was about to start a more prestigious television program. And I think he got shot out of it because he had said that practice is ridiculous. So I thought that parents would be very happy to learn this. Yeah, I'm not surprised by it. Mm-hmm. You got two things working here. Oh, one was Bernie Sanders, the presidential candidate, and his educational plan is to eliminate all non-public education, which means that the state, through the school system, would control all the all education and indoctrination. Now I don't know if he's dealing. He's going
to eliminate
parochial schools.
So he's talking about getting rid of all parochial and charter.
Well, I don't know parochial. That might be a little touchy, but all certainly charter and private schools.
Goodness,
that'd be nothing. And you asked one time, just before we left here, what did I think was the future of education? Well, the future of education is whatever the political future is.
Right. It goes hand in hand.
It goes hand in hand, because this was the whole purpose of education, mass public education, was to prepare children for the culture, to participate, to become productive members of the culture. Now, of course, we're sort of still working in a system that was instituted during the Industrial Revolution that turns out good factory workers. And maybe they're getting back to that, because for a while they were teaching science and math and things. When all originally they were intended to just teach which end of the wrench to use at the assembly line. So, what else?
You were mentioning Governor Murphy and his drive to get licenses for illegals.
Apparently, the governor had a hissy fit about we're so stupid; it's a no-brainer to give people in the country illegally driver's licenses. You got two forces working here. I have a lot of ambivalence about this, because we berate the illegal aliens, and or any other term you want to use, people in the country illegally without any documentation proving who they are. A lot of these people we meet, I've had them working at my house. They're great people.
Nice.
I would prefer them way over some of the indigenous citizenry that I run into. On the other hand, you do have people of lesser moral compunctions.
But what's legal? And has the governor even discussed or thought about what this is doing to or could do to insurance rates, auto insurance rates?
Well, the governor and others seem to feel that this is going to be peachy keen for them, because these people are all of a sudden they're going to go out and get car insurance. And they're going to become responsible drivers, and they're going to pay all the taxes involved in it, and they are going to all get insurance. Hmm. Now, that's not a pipe dream. I never heard one.
Well, if you're doing all right now without a license, why would you need a license?
Well, you'd have to ask the governor that question.
Right.
He's the only person in the state who could possibly answer it. On the other hand, there is something in people that the progressives just do not understand or have forgotten. There's something sort of bred into us. Maybe that goes back to our early training by parents who actually could and did try to steer their kids, that is repulsed by lawbreaking, because we are taught respect for the law, keep the law, and this is why we have the whole so-called correction system, is for people who don't. And so, therefore, that means that the law is of some importance, and rules and following those. And the fact that people are number one in the country illegally and performing illegal activities of one kind or another, it goes against the grain. And so I think you've got these two forces working against one another. One is there obviously are certain areas of productivity. See, what's happening here now? After the Industrial Revolution, in order to maintain a sound financial footing for a country, in order to for the country to thrive, you needed a very large, docile workforce.
Right.
And this started off women, child labor, slave labor before that. Well, let's go back to the very beginning, the most awful one of the bunch. It required slave labor. And this is back toward the last part of the latter, the 19th century, yeah. When the whole country was just booming. The South, of course, mostly agriculture, right. Manufacturing, agricultural.
And they needed
products.
Everybody to work, no yeah. matter what your status.
And so here you had, but these has to be a cheap and docile labor force. I'm sorry. You go back in England, look at the pictures they had of the old big mills they had over there, and all of these people, the miners and everything. And every people of 7 years old would be out going down on a mine right. digging. But you needed a large, to make this system work, you needed a very large and docile people who would just take it and go along with it right. force. So you had slaves who had no choice. Then you had the very poor. Then you had this huge wave of immigrants in this country. But what happened was that all of a sudden these people eventually get what I guess the industrialists would consider to be uppity. They want to get paid. And so you get the unions forming and everything. But you have this large workforce. And so because of this rise of the condition of this large workforce, they're no longer that docile and sit back and take anything. They organize and they sort of fight back. The sheep growl back at the wolves. And so, and I'm not trying to knock the system, but this is just the way the system works. And so you're getting to the point that in order to keep this whole system going, this whole wheel turning, you have to have, again, another cheap, docile workforce. Well, there you got it, in the immigrants coming in, the people coming in. They all seem to be working, those who want to. Right. So
plenty of work out there.
So the fact is that the system requires this kind of a workforce. We no longer had it. We had people who were just determined that they were not going to work. We're going to sit life out and live on the government programs of one kind or another, or people who wanted a share of the profits from this. So we can't have that. So what we have to do is open the borders.
Yeah.
That's theory. That's not a conspiracy theory, but I think it's there's some truth in that.
Bert's got a comment there.
Okay, they only want them here so they can eventually get their votes. That's right, Bert. That's certainly part of the package, too. You're absolutely correct. Because every person who comes into the country illegally, the Democrats see a Democratic vote. Because, you see, right now they're getting the reputation of supporting them, and they're going to come up with programs. And also, pretty soon, it won't be long until they're voting. Anybody got his foot over on this side of the river gets to vote. And you can see that now in this huge expansion of the mail-in ballots.
Oh, yeah.
Which is a good, convenient idea. But on the other hand, it is so rife and so open for corruption that this, of course, is why they want it.
Maybe that's the reason why they don't have online voting. I mean, you would think that in this day and age that there would be some sort of secure way to vote online.
I don't think there's any secure way to vote. Ultimately, if the authority and the powers do not want it. Well, look at it this way. It's going online. It's probably controlled by Google or Facebook or one of the carriers, Yahoo. And look what they're doing now. They're censoring out any comment that is
inappropriate
to their political view. So it'd be very easy for them to squelch votes. And most of us don't know enough about this system. You know, I had mentioned one time, I had this bright idea, let's go beyond grip, get rid of incumbent politicians, let's get rid of all politicians by simply having all this voting done electronically. Now, they can. My idea was that they would do depth interviews with eligible voters, find out all kind of information about them, and then predict the way they might vote. And then if you register, already your vote is pretty much set. Now, that sounded wacky, but it has been done. There was a program on Netflix, and it was called The Great Hack. And it is how this company, which ended up kind of getting hooted out of the business, although they didn't do anything illegal, a company in England, had actually gotten all of this information from social media. They mined it from Facebook, Google, Yahoo, everybody, and then put these profiles together, and then they used this in swing districts. in the American election in 2016. And they found out that in this, they could predict that on the fence voters who had not committed, they could influence them very easy. And they knew which voters were on the fence because they had collected all this information. Then they load their content with pro one party or the other.
Propaganda
against the other party. And they found out that actually it worked. There were some swing districts that became, in this case, Republican, that actually, according to this program now, that actually tipped the vote of your industrial states. Pennsylvania, what was it?
Ohio.
And
Michigan.
In Michigan, yeah. So anyway, you know, it's here.
Interesting.
Okay, Edward says, mailing is wrong. If you can't get out and vote, it's not important to you. That's agreed.
He's got a point.
There might be exceptions, armed forces, people stationed
right,
overseas.
Right, because this has gone, vote by mail has gone even a step further. This is more than just an absentee ballot. Like you just said, if somebody's out of the country, they're on maneuvers or they're, you know, in the military and they cannot physically get to the polls. This is not somebody who's doing a night shift somewhere that, you know, just can't make it because of their job. That's... Yeah, you're
somebody
right.
Who doesn't want to get off their butt, as Edward suggested.
Absolutely, Ed. Yep.
You know, remember in South Africa when the people first got to vote, they lined up in very bad weather, pouring rain, wind, for miles.
And this is within the last, 20, 30 years?
Yeah, I would say certainly within that framework.
With the Mandela era.
And people do it. You see these pictures in countries where people suddenly get the vote, or where suddenly the vote might be honest for the first time in their memory, and they line up and they'll stand there. The lines are longer than lining up to buy the new Apple gimmick.
Yes.
Or, you know, going to see some adenoidal rock concert to try to get in. So, so much going on here. Speaking of California, I'm a little leery about this, but it was an idea. Picture this a fantasy. Starting off with reality, we're told in San Francisco the streets are loaded with human debris. Awful. You've seen
homelessness.
Those.
Yes. Yeah. It's running
well,
rampant.
It's a coalition of the very unfortunate and the very demented. Many of these people have problems, and once some do-gooder, it became politically correct to open up institutions, and say this is cruel and unusual to put people who are mentally aberrant in these care facilities where they got good care. Generally speaking, let them out. Put them out. And this was an absolute disaster. Because it was unfair.
Right.
It was psychosis shaming or, you know, whatever the heck. But anyway, the streets out there are full of them.
Right.
We are told. And the streets, it's hard to walk around because of human waste.
Los Angeles pretty much getting the same way. But
yeah.
San Francisco is definitely the poster child.
It is the aim of this governor, apparently, to Californianize New Jersey, to make us just like California.
Well, he started out as the mayor of San Francisco.
Who?
The governor of... Are you talking about...
Oh, the governor of New Jersey.
Oh, because the mayor of San Francisco, former mayor of San Francisco, is now the governor of California.
Don't ask me who. I forgot their governor.
Newsom, I believe.
He was always a Brown for 100 years.
Right. No, but back to our governor, you're saying.
Yeah, back to our governor. And of course, his co-ideologist, they would like to... Bring pretty much the California
management. Californification of New Jersey.
Californification of New Jersey. Last couple syllables there sound like something else.
Somebody did an album on that a couple years ago.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I think
so. All right. Well, good. Anyway, if pooping in the streets and tinkling and everything is going to be in the future, I would say after I got over my first revulsion, my thought was, holy cow, at last, what I've always wanted to do. I'm going to go down and crap on the steps of the State House.
And not get...
shamed. And nobody will dare point a finger and say, yeah.
Right.
So anyway, what else is going on politically in the state of New Jersey?
Tony Bucco passed away.
Oh, he did?
Longtime Senator Tony Bucco. Suddenly, heart attack. He was 81. He was having some health concerns leading up to this, but it was a sudden passing. Nice man. Got to meet him at, he was our representative, our state senator from our district.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
His son is the assemblyman, Anthony Bucco.
So he took his son into the family business.
Right.
Yeah.
So, but Tony passed away after he was 81, heart attack. And, you know, he is a voice of reason up there. He did a lot of good for the Morris County area that he served. Yeah.
You know, just staying in the sort of the political vein here. Oh, I don't think we mentioned this last week. Sleaze Bob, our Sleaze Bob SquarePants, you know, Senator Menendez, one of the two clowns who are our senators from New Jersey. And here's what is rather ironic. He is pushing what? Care for flying dogs.
Oh,
remember that?
Oh, yeah, we meant to get
somehow
that. Oh, the helicopter.
To be sure that dogs who fly in helicopters don't fall out, I guess, is the thing.
Oh, with the sightseeing helicopters?
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Want to prohibit
Now, how
dogs?
Many are there, regarding or in relationship to the population? How many, you know, the helicopter view people who will take a dog? They probably got some little white dust bunny thing in their lap.
But you're not talking.
So
like
he's all excited. He and Senator Schumer are terrified that one of these dogs is going to fall out. They haven't done it.
And that's his priority. Yeah.
Yeah. Now, also, he's having a war on beach umbrellas.
Right. Yep,
one person, I think, got hit, and it was certainly not a fatal hit, by a beach umbrella. Right. Now, here we go, the world. All things going on in this country, falling apart, the brink of certainly civil Cold War, and economic problems. We're talking about these poor people out on the streets and everything. A war right now about to break out, and this could be a huge one in the Middle East,
yes,
because the Saudi Arabia has to fight back against Iran, who destroyed half their oil production. Right. What else are you going to do? These are problems. And what are they worried about? Is somebody's dog falling out of a helicopter?
These are not even first world problems.
You know what? Remember Les Nessman and the turkeys?
Of course.
The old WKRP Cincinnati?
Yeah, the big Thanksgiving promotion.
Yeah, Thanksgiving promotion. They were going to drop turkeys out of a helicopter.
And by golly, they did.
And they did. And but the turkeys, they were live turkeys. And the turkeys just plummeted and fell. And Les Nessman, the newsman, did a parody when he saw this happening. He did a parody of that famous speech
at the Hindenburg.
The Hindenburg thing.
Oh,
the humanity, my God.
Oh, a turkey just fell in somebody's windshield.
And his outline, the last line of the show was, "On my word before God, I didn't know turkeys couldn't fly."
Yeah.
Let's see. Let's get back to Jason wanted to talk about the vote. People don't vote because they feel both parties are in the same right. Twiddle-dum, twiddle-dee. The independent vote doesn't get a fair shake. Half the voting population are registered independents. More than half, Jason, I think, in New Jersey. I am. I was registered to the Democratic Party until they started transforming into something entirely different.
Right.
So I changed mine back.
But the problem here, we have become a one-party state. I mean,
yeah.
I was talking to Bill this morning. Who is the number one Republican?
Well, this
is
the problem. Republicans have not produced a charismatic, and this is what it's all about, really. It's who's handsomest, comes out best with the ladies at the focus group and the like. We haven't had one since Governor Kaine.
And that's a long, long time.
Now, Governor Christie had two things when he, a Republican, became elected governor. Under normal circumstances, there's no possible way. Number one, though, is that he had gotten a lot of good publicity being the U.S. attorney
and
cracking down on crime. Number two is, it is my considered opinion, John Corzine didn't really want to be elected. He didn't really fight for it very hard. He told me one time, sitting in conversation just like this, I said, "How are you enjoying the job, being governor?" He said, "Well, yeah, but I said, what I really miss is being in finance. That's what I really like. I love finance." And so when the time came around to renew this, he played the game.
Yeah.
But I don't think he really had his heart in the campaign.
That's
so, and also money is playing. Eric Scott and I used to surmise that Jim McGreevy would be the last middle-class governor of New Jersey because money. You take the Corzine. Chris Christie was not a poor man, but not in that league, so won't count him. And then the current governor, who, of course, you buy the nomination by certainly cozying up to and paying off the county chairman. And they, of course, turn out the faithful at the polls.
And that's the way
it's overwhelmingly
Democratic. That's the way it's gone. But you're right that Governor McGreevy was probably the last homegrown middle-class governor.
And I don't count Governor Cody, who would be, and who was one of my favorite governors.
But he was appointed.
Unfortunately, he was appointed. Well, he succeeded McGreevy.
Right.
But he did a great job as governor. He should have been elected governor. He had the highest approval ratings of any governor in a poll's ever taken.
He would have won hands down.
But Corzine came in with the money. And so...
Shame.
The popular, certainly, sentiment was for Dick Cody, but had it been given a chance. But it turned out that he didn't have that chance because the Pauls wanted the money. You see, the more money that the candidate can put up, the less they have to spend in party money. And, of course, yes. That goes, you know...
And that's got to go 21 ways. Other counties than others, right?
George says... Turkeys can fly, just not very well.
Yeah, they need a couple more thousand feet of
altitude. Hey, George, let me tell you something. George, I don't know if you're familiar with Ambrose Bierce. He was an American writer from San Francisco. He used to be a columnist. He wrote a book called The Devil's Dictionary, and he had definitions of things. One of the definitions was from an ostrich. And as George has suggested, Ambrose Bierce defined an ostrich as a large bird... the absence of a working set of wings is of no inconvenience to an ostrich because he doesn't fly anyway. Well, leave that out. I came in this morning Lou Hockman, our producer here, had sent me a list of the stories that were getting all the attention. Mm-hmm. One was this great Jewing down flap, I guess you could call it.
Oh, over in
the
in
council
Trenton.
In Trenton, in which a member of the council at some sort of a meeting had talked to a person who apparently had reduced the price of something. I don't know, this is generally how it works. And this person made sort of a humorous comment, he or she thought, I'm not sure, I think it was a lady, if I'm not mistaken, but I don't know. And she just made this, you know, smiling comment and said, oh, well, sorry that they had to Jew you down. Hmm. Now, that is
an old
cliche.
Yeah.
So the question comes up, is that anti-Semitic? My take is, yes, and it's low-level anti-Semitic. This is not to say that I would use it, although I'm certain I have. I have also, in time, referred to a chaos as a Chinese fire drill. Although the Chinese are the best behaved people in the world. But that got into play, and we generally try to lay off stuff like that, and that's okay. That's no problem. But so far as the Jewing down, it goes with a stereotype, an ancient stereotype, that the Jewish people are what parsimonious, and they will try to... get your price down. Well, that is simply part of a culture that is not just theirs alone. But it goes by Merchant of Venice, the play, Shakespeare's play. You get Shylock. You get these figures who are what stereotypical of the fact that if you're dealing with a Jewish person, he's going to try to cut the price down. It doesn't hurt anybody. It certainly was not intended to somehow destroy or offend a whole ethnic
group.
Or
disparage an
entire. So I would say, yes, it is anti-Semitic, but if there's such a thing as an innocent area of it. So my suggestion is, you know, the one good thing, it got the expression out in the public, so don't use it. Yeah. There's other things that you can use.
Life is a verbal minefield now.
Well, everybody has to walk on eggshells.
Yes.
No, I would say the Jewish people certainly did not rise up, you know, in something about it. I think they understand that. I mean, these are big people. They've been around. And that's not the worst thing in the world that, you know, certainly has ever happened. But, you're right. It's a minefield, and you walk on eggshells because everybody wants to be offended. Because since the dawn of political correctness, we find out that if you are a victim, everybody wants to be a victim.
Everybody
you
wants
get special privileges, or you can.
Oh, that's right.
And you can even get stuff.
You get all the attention. Stuff.
You
government stuff.
Oh, that I mentioned this last week. I don't know. I got to do it again because I thought it was great. There was a poll taken among a big number of college students about their political leanings. It turns out that most college students, very high percentage, lean toward the Democratic Party platform and would certainly vote that way. And they were asked, which form of government do you support or prefer? And they would have democracy, republic,
socialism.
Well, communism, socialism was mentioned, of course, socialism. 30-some percent said socialism. They preferred socialism. When they asked them why, very large percentage of them said, believe it or not, that's because they encourage socializing, you know, people having fun.
Talking to people. And,
that was a large, and another large percentage, practically closing out the percentile, said, well, if they have socialism, they give you free stuff.
Yes.
So this is how our enlightened generation in college is.
I'm not surprised, buddy.
We're running down here, and someday I got to do my fair play for Colonel Sanders thing.
Well, do you got time to do it now?
I don't know.
We have time.
Do we have time?
Yeah,
I don't know.
We got another couple.
Look
minutes,
around so, here.
Yeah,
huh?
We have time.
Well, how come Lou is holding the door open and pointing?
Oh, I think he's got lunch. He just wants to.
We got time. You want to go on?
Dan wants to.
Dan, you want to hear about Colonel Sanders?
Yeah.
Well, the reason I do this, you've seen the commercials now for the product. And they have this total horse's backside dressed as the colonel, purporting to be Colonel Sanders.
He's a caricature of the
real
caricature.
Colonel Sanders, and I do this to some extent because I knew Colonel Sanders when he was first starting, just by accident. I was working at a radio station. I was going to college in Salem, Virginia, Roanoke College. And Colonel Sanders, I was working for a radio station. Our sales manager was acting as an advertising director for a couple of restaurants. A man named, I think his name was Leonard Cohen, Lindy's Restaurants at the time down there, just purely local. And he said, yeah, you want to come over? There's an old guy coming in. He's going to cook chicken, and he's trying to get it installed here in the restaurants. And, you know, he's going to cook some up, so come on over. So I did. You have never tasted chicken like Colonel Sanders cooked.
Did he
it
use
was
the,
different.
The pressure cookers? Or?
Oh, yeah. Well, it was pressure cookers, but I can't tell you because it was secret. He had a white Ford station wagon. In the back were about a dozen burlap sacks full of his secret ingredients that he made for the batter. And the chicken parts were actual chicken parts. The product now is God knows what.
Yeah.
And back in those days, if you wanted to get cut up chicken parts, put it together, it would do everything but fly. You know, it would look like a chicken. This, God knows what you'd get if you put these parts together. But anyway, I met Colonel Sanders, got to spend some time with him, and he was a delightful and a very impressive man. He was in his 70s at the time, and of course he wore the Kentucky thing. And one thing he insisted for his advertising, he said, any advertising, any picture, I want all my chicken served in this bucket. It has to have my mug on it. I want my mug on it. And I know he was death on smoking. A couple of us smoked at the time, and he didn't put up with that. But here, let me give you something of his background. This is I'll try to get through this. Colonel Sanders, Harlan Sanders, born down in Kentucky, he had to look out and support his family. He started helping support his family from the age of 7. Now, this was tough times. He worked as a farmhand when he was 10 years old. He graduated, when he was a little older, to horse carriage painting. He was a streetcar conductor, I think, in Louisville, but I'm not sure exactly where. He worked as a blacksmith for the Southern Railroad. He was a locomotive fireman. And all this crammed into a lifetime. He got a law degree through the LaSalle University Extension, which I guess was the Philadelphia?
Yes.
I guess the Extension course.
So.
He studied law. He practiced law, but he got disbarred for beating up the opposing attorney one time during a dispute in sum up. Yeah, he's good at fisticuffs, too. He sold life insurance. He was operated a ferry boat one time. He was the secretary of Chamber of Commerce in Columbus, Ohio. He was a Michelin tire salesman. He opened the first Esso station, Shell station, in his state.
Wow.
And let's see, there's more than that. He was listed, he had this filling station, I mean, which actually garage, but he had a little restaurant on the side. It's kind of like now you fill up your car and you run in and get your pork rinds and RC colas, you know, whatever the hustle.
So he was one of
But he actually was serving people this chicken. And he got listed on the Duncan Hines, which was the big authority on dining at the time, top 10 small eating places in the country.
Wow.
The stuff was so good. Now, he also was mentioned in a book called Adventures in Good Eating. So after all of these jobs, he settled down and sort of out of desperation, there was an available filling station in town, and he got it started this. But he sold some gas, but also this restaurant sort of blossomed. And that's how he sort of got into this. Then it was suggested that he franchise this out.
Yeah.
And the first place he got actually was in Salt Lake City, of all places. Somebody there had passed through and gotten some of his chicken and says, hey, I got some restaurants up here. Why don't you come up and put it in? It was hugely successful. So then he got back. He got on the road. This is how I met him. And he was traveling around making this chicken. And it was absolutely, out of this world. He made it. Then this restaurant, they bought it. Lenny's bought it. Then it was bought out by, it went to Gino's. That's where they got big.
Okay.
Remember Gino's?
Yes.
Gino Marchetti and Alan Amici, the two.
They brought in the hamburgers.
Running backs.
The hamburger line on the, with that.
So well, it was Gino's restaurants were forerunners of, I guess, well, KFC existed at the time.
Yes.
But it was more like Burger King, I think, in their menu. And
yes,
all.
Yes.
But Gino's was very big on the East Coast.
Right.
And it so. Is. He eventually, and again, traveling around with his station wagon and going into these restaurants and cooking for the help and letting them decide whether they'd sell the product or not. Well, of course, it exploded. It boomed.
Yeah.
And was very successful. But I often feel very bad when I happen, before I can get to the mute button to cut these commercials off.
Commercials, yeah.
Because here was a man of such ability and such a really fine person.
Yeah.
And have him depicted as a horse's ass is just, it bothers me.
Well, I know you're not. Well, I know you're not a big fast food guy. I mean, I think you said last one time that you haven't had a Big Mac since 1973.
You remember that?
Oh, I remember that.
That's the last fast food I had. I had a Big Mac. I was in Seattle working at the time, and I got a Big Mac. It was absolutely delicious. And so I said, this is like shooting up with something, for some people, given my predilections toward addictions.
But Colonel Sanders, I wonder what he would say today with the chicken restaurant wars going on between Chick-fil-A and now Popeyes. They got that big chicken sandwich thing going on where, one's better than the other and one sold out. I think Popeyes sold out of their chicken, so they're out of stock until like the middle of next month. And then now KFC, I don't know if you heard this, KFC is coming up with this new invention. Chicken patty surrounded by glazed donut.
Excuse me.
Do you believe that? Can you believe
a
that?
A what?
Yes, chicken patty, and this is going to be in a test market. They're trying for the next thing. Chicken patty surrounded by two glazed donuts.
So we have 60% of the American population so obese they are going to become diabetic and other diseases. You're shortening the lifespan. The lifespan of Americans is actually going down. And here. Well, you see, I'm amazed. I'm a sort of a disciplined eater, really. I eat very good stuff, organic. I'm sort of a vegetarian who does eat meat when the spirit moves me to do so. I eat a lot of fish. And I go into a market, and you see the stuff that people are loading into these carts like they're going on an Arctic expedition. And I expect a dog sled out in the parking lot. They're going to go to the pole.
People are stocking up. You go to some of these wholesale places? My God.
And the biggest aisles in the market that I go to, which is pretty typical of them, sodas on one side, which is nothing but sugar water, and snacks, chips, and the like on the other side of the aisle, cookies and all going all the way down. Now, somebody is buying this, in spite of the fact that all evidence is
and
this is going to take years off your life.
And every news story, from here for the last 10 years telling you that most of that stuff is bad for you.
Yeah.
Especially in excess.
Well, people don't buy it. Well, I don't know if anybody bought anything we talked about today.
Time for lunch.
But it's time for lunch.
Whatever you're having.
Yeah. What are you having for lunch?
Probably a protein bar.
Just that?
And a banana.
Well, now, look at the ingredients on your protein bar. It's probably going to be half sugar.
You're probably right.
I don't know. I haven't seen. There are some that aren't.
Maybe I'll have two bananas instead. Two bananas would be very good. I'll go without the protein.
A lot of potassium. You'll sleep better.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Your tummy will thank you for it.
How about you?
Huh?
What are you going to have?
When I go
home. Oh, you
home,
got your free fruit here.
Well,
it's free
fruit day. Is
from
it
the
just
Ewing,
Thursday they do
No, every day. Yeah. Ewing Diner comes
Yeah,
in.
I will have fruit. I will have, I think, a bowl of bean mixture that I make with all kind of beans and vegetables in there. And I also make a mix of rice and black quinoa that I have it over that.
Okay.
Then the Twinkies. No, I won't do that. I won't do that.
Okay.
Yeah, but I live largely on a salad. But, I like it.
You've lived healthy all of these years.
Well,
God
I've always done. Once when I was in the Navy, I think salt, and this has done me well. One time when I was in the Navy, the food in the mess hall was so salty, I quit eating any. Mm. You know, I'd either scrape it off or I wouldn't put anything. And so I sort of got an aversion to that.
Most prepared foods, it's oversalted anyway, so you shouldn't even have a salt shaker on your table.
The basic thing is that I do not eat prepared food. I'm 5'10", I weigh 163 pounds, and yesterday, I've got to tell you this, or in the last couple of days, this has been absolutely incredible. I moved 63, because that was on the flat, 63 50-pound bags of marble chips.
Wow.
Carried them to the garden, opened it up, spread them out. Then I had ordered 100 of these Belgian blocks, 30-pound granite blocks, made a 90-foot garden border, ordered 4 tons of red gravels, and spread them. That's in three days.
Wow.
So you get a little exercise.
I'd say
along
so.
With
I'm
that.
Getting tired just listening to this.
Well, it's fun, really. It's amazing.
That's amazing. You
now,
are...
I'll probably go out of here and fall over before I get to the door.
See you next time.
Okay, good. Thanks. Right. Thanks, everybody.
Okay.
Gearhart's back.
The more things change, the more they stay the same.
From NJ1015.com, this is the new Jim Gearhart Podcast.